how technology works, but we're going to still go with God. I'm going to ask Dr. Anita Harris to open our broadcast with a word of prayer. It just came back up. Somebody ought to say, somebody must have been interceding for Command Your Morning today. Dr. Anita Harris, take us in with a word of opening prayer.
Lord, we just want to say thank you this morning, God, first of all, for allowing us to see another day that you have made. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for just intervening, Lord, and just making sure that the broadcast go forth, God, as it always has, God, with no interruptions, with no disturbance, Lord, with no interference with technology. Everything will go well, and we give you praise and we give you glory, God. And Lord, we just thank you, Lord, for your word, Lord, that's going forth this morning, Lord, for it is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path, God. And Lord, we just ask you, Lord, to continue, Lord, to use your vessel, God, Lord, to bring forth your word, to share your word, Lord, to preach your gospel, God, Lord, that others may hear your word, Lord, and they may be changed, God, in your son Jesus' name, Lord, that they may be delivered, Lord, that their prayers may be answered, God. And Lord, we just thank you, Lord, for moving on our behalf in this day, God. We thank you, Lord, for being Jehovah Jireh, God. Thank you for God that provides everything that we need, God. Lord, both in the natural and spiritually, Lord, we just thank you, Lord. And we give you praise, we give you glory, God, for these and all blessings in your son Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, woman of God. So this morning, we're going to continue with Lord, send revival. Somebody needs to hashtag or say that. If you're taking notes, say that. If you're in the bathroom this morning, say that. If you're getting dressed for work, Lord, send revival. If we're asking the Lord to send revival, then we have got to be excited about it for ourselves. We've got to be excited about the request that we have made. So as we're asking the Lord to send revival, then we have already got to begin to rejoice, begin to praise, begin to worship, begin to rise up early, live at 5 with joy and with just be excited about God today. That excitement must be evident in the person praying for revival. And so this morning we're going to just kind of piggyback briefly on what we shared yesterday, because we talked about the importance of revival and one of the things that hinders gets in the way, and we talked about how we know we need revival, and one of the things that we talked about was how we recognize when individuals or ministries or believers are in a backslidden state. And we took some characteristics from Richard Roberts' book entitled Revival. We shared yesterday that these characteristics are evidence that revival is needed. So if you found yourself in either one of those 25 characteristics, then revival is needed. If you saw some areas in your life that you know need to be changed, if you left your first love, if you're no longer excited about God, if you're no longer on fire for God, if you're letting other things get in the way of worship for God, you're letting other things get in the way of working for God, you're making all kinds of excuses for not using your spiritual gift, and revival is needed. Yesterday, as we got ready to close, we went to the book of Revelation, chapter 2, and I shared that the opportunity for spiritual resuscitation is now. We read where the Apostle John wrote to the church at Ephesus in Revelation chapter 2 as Jesus spoke, "Nevertheless, I have this against you, that you have left your first love." He said in verse 5, "Remember, therefore, from where you have fallen, repent and do the first works, or else I will come to you quickly and remove your lampstand from its place unless you repent." I mentioned yesterday as we got ready to close that there are three verbs in this text which are each given in the form of a command. And those three verbs are remember, repent, and the phrase do the first works. Somebody say remember, repent, and do the first works. The Bible says in verse 5, remember from where you have fallen. How do we come out of this backslidden state? How do we pull out of this and get to a place of revival? How do we get out of this place of stagnation and lack of excitement? How do we get out of this place where we've gotten complacent in our relationship with God? We've gotten so complacent that we're getting to a place that we're forgetting about God. Remember, repent, do the first works. The scripture says in Revelation, remember from where you have fallen. And I said yesterday that the first step toward restoration and revival is to remember where you started to fall away from God. Where did you first begin to fall away from God? It's almost like a marriage, because in marriage counseling, oftentimes we'll ask people to remember when you first fell in love. Go back to what things were like when you first fell in love, and then try to figure out what happened to cause you to drift away. That's the same way it is with God. What happened? Listen, remember what it was like when you were on fire for God. You were telling everybody about God. You were spending time in prayer. You were doing everything you needed to do. You were studying the Word of God every single day. You were excited about the Word. You were excited about sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ with other people. You didn't have a problem telling people on your job about Jesus. You didn't have a problem going to the drive-thru and giving tracts to the cashier. You didn't have a problem, listen, letting the people in your family know who you believe. You were not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so where did you start to drift away? Where did you start to drift away? What influence? The drift, so remember from which you have fallen. And then the second part of Revelation chapter 2, talking to the church at Ephesus, the Lord says repent. And repent means to change one's mind or completely turn away from that pattern of behavior, completely turn away from that thing that you're doing that does not honor the Lord. If you're going to come out of that backslidden state, you got to completely turn away from rigid religious mentality. You got to completely turn away from loving money more than you do God. You got to completely turn away from those unhealthy situations that you've got yourself in that is causing you to fall into idolatry. And so thereby repent, turn away from that pattern of behavior or from that thing, that issue, that situation, that person, that job, that money, that material thing that has caused you to drift away from God. If you want to see revival, you got to do the first works again. That's what we shared yesterday. Do the first works. Do the kind of good works that characterize the love you first had with God. Oh, God, somebody needs to read that in the next session with your couples. Go back and do the first works. Do the kind of work, the fire, the work, the evangelism, the work, the prayer, the work. Do the kind of work that demonstrated the love that you first had for God. And as shared yesterday as I closed, how do you do the first works? Go back to spending time with Him, study the Word, get back to your doing the work of ministry. And so thereby, when we begin to do this, this is when we would begin to see revival in the life of a believer. And I said the job of the intercessor is to pray for the Lord to send revival. And so today, part two, Lord, send revival, part two. There are some different principles that can help lead to revival, some biblical principles. And we're going to go back and visit some principles in the Old Testament, because if you go back to the Old Testament revivals yield biblical principles that help us in praying for revivals. No two revivals are alike. But I'm going to release some principles this morning that are evident in the Old Testament that demonstrate how we can get to a place of revival. Most Old Testament revivals were preceded by a time of deep spiritual decline and despair. And so when things begin to decline around you, when things begin to decline, watch this. Don't you believe that our nation has been in a spiritual decline. So there are some in the body of Christ that are in a spiritual decline and despair. This pandemic, for some, I know it's brought revival in many areas, but for some, it's brought some spiritual decline and despair, because even in this pandemic, there are still people that are not giving their lives to Jesus Christ. Somebody say, Lord, send revival. When things begin to decline around us and we are tempted to get into despair, I want to encourage you to rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice, because when you begin to rejoice, you may be on the brink of revival. Each revival in the Old Testament began in the heart of one individual. It began in the heart of one man. And somebody say, all their needs is, I look for a man, in Ezekiel, I look for a man to stand in the gap, but found no one. It starts with one man, and that one man became the instrument that God used to encourage and influence and stir other people to revival. And so as God begins to touch our hearts with the fire of revival, this is what happened at Brownsville. The Lord touched the pastor's heart with the fire of revival, and this is why he prayed to him. I don't know if he's still alive, and he may be listening to us this morning. To God be the glory. I pray that you're honored by us honoring you. But listen, as he began to pray 20 minutes a day for revival, it was because God touched his heart with the fire of revival. And when that happens, you'll begin to fan the revival flame in other people. In other words, when people see you are on fire, they'll run for miles just to watch you burn. I need somebody to say revival fire, revival fire. I believe there's a ministry named Revival Fire. And I asked the question the other day, does the name attached to your ministry reflect the activity of your ministry? Since I mentioned that, I'm not calling out any particular ministry, that just came to mind, Revival Fire. I probably heard it recently or saw the name recently. But, oh my, I just remember where I saw it. But anyway, to God be the glory. I know that particular ministry is demonstrating the activity behind their name. I know that this particular ministry that I'm thinking about, this is why it came to my mind this morning. I know that the activity of their ministry reflects the name of their ministry, because I know this leader is on fire for God, and he is always trying to ignite the fire in other people. He's always trying to ignite and revive the flame in other people, that revival, trying to fan the revival flame in other people. So thereby, does the activity of your ministry reflect the name of your ministry reflect the activity of your ministry, or vice versa, does the activity of your ministry reflect the name on your ministry? When people see Upper Room Outreach Ministries, because of what the Upper Room represented in the book of Acts, people should not only see Upper Room doing outreach, which we do often, they should not only see us doing outreach, but in the Upper Room, there should be consistent prayer and consistent power. Can I say that again? In the Upper Room, there was prayer, and there was God's presence, and there was power that was released as Holy Spirit came in, and the fire of God, the tongues of fire, the presence of God, the wind, the breath of God came in. And so because the name of our ministry is the Upper Room Outreach Ministries, we should watch this, because Upper Room is mentioned first. We should be seeing prayer. We should be seeing the presence of God should be evident. The power of God should be evident, and outreach should be evident. And so thereby, does the name reflect the activity of your ministry? And so every Old Testament revival rested on the proclamation of the Word of God. The message of revival should focus on sin. And many times, I know, as I said yesterday to somebody, that all of us in ministry have a different assignment. You can probably name certain pastors and certain evangelists, and you can tell how God uses them. There are certain people I know that one person that I have in mind, God uses her to minister in the area of joy. There's another leader that many of us know very well, God uses her in the area of deliverance. There are other ministers that we know very well, God uses them to minister financial prosperity. And I'm telling you, for people who criticize leaders who preach on financial prosperity, don't minimize the gospel message because you don't understand the assignment of the preacher. I need somebody to help me say amen. Don't minimize the message because you don't understand. A lot of times people are critical of the messenger because they don't understand the assignment that God has given the messenger. Some people say are what we call witch killers. They minister in the area of warfare. That's their main strength in the kingdom is warfare. Some people's main strength in the kingdom is encouragement and motivation and empowerment. And so thereby, be critical of the messenger because you don't understand their assignment in the kingdom. And so thereby, there are those that have different assignment in the kingdom, and God uses, there are different administrations, but there's only one spirit behind. There is one spirit, one spirit, one source of how God uses individual, and that's Holy Spirit is God. And so thereby, each Old Testament revival, the message should focus on sin, hell, and God's judgment, and not just power, not just love, not just peace, and not just prosperity. Those are when we proclaim and we are preaching and the message of revival, it should oftentimes be what we call an evangelistic message. And an evangelistic message seeks to minister to the lost. Edificational messages seem to empower the saints. And so thereby, we cannot leave anybody out when we are preaching and delivering messages of revival. I want to go to some passages because I want to talk about Moses' message of revival in Deuteronomy chapter 11, starting at verse 26. Let's talk about Moses' message of revival, and this is going to give us some type kind of idea as to how revival messages, and of course, God gives us the message that we need to preach. Holy Spirit reveals to us what is needed at that time and for that moment. So by all means, preach what God has given you for the people, for the moment that we're in. Deuteronomy chapter 11, this is the message of revival that was released through Moses. Deuteronomy chapter 11 and verse 26. I'm going to read this from the New King James, starting at verse 26 of Deuteronomy chapter 11. It says, "Behold, I set before you today a blessing and a curse. Watch this, the blessing, if you obey the commandments of the Lord, of your Lord God, which I command you this day." So this message, the underlying message here, is obedience to the commands of God. Samuel revival message, 1 Samuel chapter 7 and verse 3. 1 Samuel chapter 7 and verse 3. It says in the New King James, "Then Samuel spoke to all the house of Israel, saying, if you return to the Lord with all your hearts, then put away the foreign gods and the Asherahs from among you, the idols from among you, and prepare your hearts for the Lord, and serve him only, he will deliver you from the hand of the Philistines." If you return to the Lord with all your hearts, the message here is a message of repentance. a message of repent. If you return or repent, return to the Lord with all your heart, then put away the foreign gods, put away your idols, put away your foreign gods, and prepare your hearts for the Lord and serve him only. And he will deliver you from the hands of the Philistines. Repentance leads to deliverance. Repentance leads to deliverance. I won't go there this morning. Ezekiel 33, verse 7 through 8. Can I say that again? Repentance. Repent. Deliverance. Ezekiel chapter 33, verse 7 and 8, New King James. So you son of man, I have made you a watchman for the house of Israel. Therefore you shall hear a word from my mouth and warn them for me. And so thereby in revival messages, there are times that the Lord will use you to give a message to warn the people. He will use the individuals to warn the people. And so therefore, you shall hear a word from my mouth and warn them for me. I heard one individual, and I'm not saying there were not others, but I know God used this woman of God to warn us about this pandemic. I did not hear her message until we were already in the midst of the pandemic, but about 2 years ago, God used this woman of God to warn people about what was coming. The problem with many people is that there are times when God releases a warning that if it doesn't happen next week, if it doesn't happen within a certain amount of time, the people go back to being complacent. They go back to doing what they always did. They go back to living to disobeying the commands of God. They go back to unforgiveness. They go back to jealousy. They go back to whoremongering. They go back to backbiting. They go back to all kinds of things because they heard the warning, but it didn't happen in the timing that they thought. Oh, if God's gonna do it, he's gonna do it. He would have already done it. Or they put the warning out of their minds. And this woman of God, I know, even though she did not know exactly what to call it, God used her to warn the people about this virus. He used her to warn the people about a death happening. Every time you turn around, somebody dying. God used this woman. But how many people actually heeded the warning? So in Ezekiel, it says in verse 7, so you son of man, I have made you a watchman for the house of Israel. Therefore you shall hear a word from my mouth and warn them for me when I say to the wicked, O wicked man, you shall surely die. And you do not speak to warn the wicked from his way. That wicked man shall die in his iniquity, but his blood I will require at your hand. When Holy Spirit gives us a word for the people, a word of warning, no matter what the word is, and we don't release it, the blood of the people is on our hands. And so nevertheless, if you warn the wicked to turn from his way and he does not turn from his way, he shall die in his iniquity, but you have delivered your soul. In other words, if you tell them what I told you to tell them, if you tell them what God told you to tell them, and they don't listen, it's no longer on you. If you tell them, somebody say, Lord, send revival. If you tell them what I told you to tell them and they don't listen, they don't turn from their way, and they die in their iniquity because you obeyed me and released a warning, I'm not going to hold this to your account. You have delivered your soul because you obeyed me and warned the people. Sometimes people don't obey God. They don't warn the people because they're afraid. Watch this. They are afraid of what the people are going to do. They're afraid of what the people are going to say. They're afraid that if I warn them and I say what God said, this is a little bit strong, I'm going to have people that's going to leave my ministry. That's what we call in society a people pleaser. But I believe there's somewhere in the Word of God that says it's better to obey God than man. In our studies the other night, we cannot minimize or water down the message that God has given us, even when it's a message of warning. This woman of God, God used her mightily. I've heard people say that God told me about this, the Lord showed me this, but I'm not saying nobody else has been as accurate as she was, but I haven't heard it with my ears. God used that woman to warn about this virus. Elijah, 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 21. 1 Kings chapter 18 and verse 21. It says, and I'm going to say this about those in the prophetic. God does use prophets in different ways, too. Let me just make that clear for those. And that may not have been the message for that prophet, but that doesn't mean that God is not using them. 1 Kings 18:21. It says in the New King James, and Elijah came to all the people and said, how long will you falter between two opinions? If the Lord is God, follow him. But if Baal, follow him. But the people the people answer him not a word. So he's listening. You got to choose who you're going to follow. You got to choose who you're going to worship. These are different revival messages in the Old Testament as delivered through Moses, Samuel, Ezekiel, and Elijah. Quick break for station ID. We are live at 5. On WHLJ 97.5 FM, talking about Lord, Send Revival Part 2. We're talking about how intercessors can pray for the Lord to send revival. We're live at 5 on WHLJ 97.5 FM, Statenville, Valdosta, Moultrie, Georgia. We're also online at Foxy, F-O-X-Y. 97.com, and you can join us on the call at 712-770-4010. Access code 266-590. There'll be a recap tonight at 7 p.m. on WHLJ. Let me tell you what happens when the people repent. Repentance always preceded revival. Repentance always preceded revival, and they were told to put away their gods. And so repentance included destruction of every idol. And so thereby, what are those idols that are keeping you from revival? What are those things that are more important than God? What are those things that are taking priority over God and what God wants you to do in the kingdom? Those things have become an idol, and they're keeping us from revival. There was a return to proper priorities, including concern for other people, keeping of the Sabbath, giving and praying, and the Word of God. In the Old Testament, there was a return to the genuine worship of God in the Old Testament. This worship was not cold. It was not ritualistic, but the people were excited. They were responsive to the message that was preached, and so thereby they responded to God and the Word of God. Every revival was followed by a time of productivity, prosperity, joy, and gladness. Somebody say, I won't listen. It's time now for revival. So that it's time now for productivity. It's time for the joy of the Lord to be our strength. It's time for the people, even in the middle of this pandemic, to rejoice and be exceedingly glad. What are some of the things that get in the way of revival? I really want to finish this today because one of our students shared something that I really want to get out this morning. Where leaders can get in the way of revival. Leaders who really don't care about the sheep. Leaders who really don't care about their congregation can get in the way of revival. I was in listening to many, many years ago a ministry that was getting ready to have a service. Their annual revival is what it was called. Sometimes the people are not ready for the annual revival. When there is strife, when there is division, when there is discord, listen, you want to have revival, but we got to have prayer. We got to repent from all these wrong attitudes if we want to see revival, because remember yesterday, revival is not just about a series of services. And the revival can take place. And so unless the power of God is evident in those services. And so thereby, in Monday night's class this past week on homiletics, which is the art or science of preaching, we talked about the responsibility of the pastor and the shepherd. We talked about how the ministry of the Word of God must take priority in the life of the pastor. In our class on Monday night, which was, I'm telling you, this homiletics class has been, extremely exciting. We discussed what happens when the shepherd properly feeds the sheep. Number one, we said that when the word is preached properly, it brings rest to the sheep. We said that when the word is preached properly, it will bring authority and it will cause gathering. When the word is preached properly, it will produce healthy reproductive sheep. The sheep will be reproducing for the glory of Jesus Christ. When there is not effective preaching going on, failure to rightly divide or cut straight the word of truth, when the pastor fails to study and prepares to spend time in prayer and fails to prepare and preach and teach with power and authority, when the leader is lacking in passion for the word of God and love for the people of God, that's when revival is hindered. That is when revival is hindered. Why did the Brownsville revival, why was this revival so successful? First of all, because the pastor was a person of prayer. Secondly, because he had a passion for the word. And third, because he had love for people. If we want to see revival, then we got to be people of prayer. We got to have a passion for the word of God. And we got to love people, because we want to see revival in the lives of others. And if we want to see it, that's why we're preaching this message, because we love people. It's not just because we want to be on the radio and we want people to hear our voice. I know there's a lot of voices that you could be listening to. It's not about me. It's about God, and it's about seeing revival in the lives of people. And so when a pastor neglects to pray and have a passion for the word and neglects to have a love for the people, they are not leading the people in what Psalm 23 says, in green pastures and still waters. Because it's the green pastures and the still waters that is necessary to revive the people. Can I get somebody to say, go to Psalm 23. It is the green pastures and the still waters. He leads me beside the still waters. And what happens when you're led beside the still waters? There is revival taking place. Leaders who have lost their passion for evangelism hinder revival. Many of us do not recognize our responsibility to be leaders in revival. Let's go to Joel chapter 2. I got to wrap it up. It's almost time. Joel chapter 2. Joel chapter 2, verse 15 through 18. I got to talk about this. It says, blow the trumpet of Zion, consecrate a fast, call a sacred assembly, gather the people, sanctify the congregation, assemble the elders, gather the children and the nursing babes. Let the bridegroom go out from his chamber and the bride from her dressing room. Let the priest who minister to the Lord weep between the porch and the altar. Let them say, spare your people, O Lord, and do not give your heritage to reproach, that the nation should rule over them. Why should they say among the people, where is their God? We have a great responsibility as leaders in revival. Come on, pastor. Come on, shepherd. And then the congregation can also affect revival. There can be obstacles in the congregation. The congregation's love of tradition can interfere with revival. Revival and change are synonymous. Somebody stated not too long ago that if the church must run according to the traditions of men, it will run without the power and presence of God. In Mark chapter 7, verse 17, Jesus said to the scribes and the Pharisees, making the word of God of no effect through your tradition, which you have handed down, and many such things you do. In this particular text, the Pharisees thought that their religious acts was something that pleased God. Their traditions were passed down from generation to generation. It had become the norm, and nobody questioned it, or nobody questioned the motives behind it. In other words, listen, it must be all right if everybody is doing it. Jesus was rebuking them for a lot of reasons, as well as for their hypocrisy. And he stressed this fact many times, that they had held up their traditions above the commands of God. In other words, their traditions was more important than obedience to God. What they thought was pleasing God was actually done in vain. And as it was then with the Pharisees, so it is with many today. There are a lot of things that people are doing that they think are pleasing to God, but they're actually doing it in vain. Unless the Lord builds a house, those that labor, labor in vain. And so if God is not in it, ladies and gentlemen, listen, that is a hindrance to revival. Is God in what we're doing, even in the church? Or is it just routine? Is it just because somebody else is doing it? Is it because I'm just seeing somebody else do it? Once again, on Monday night, we discuss why certain scripture is often misinterpreted. And we are out of, oh, God, we're going to talk about this Monday morning because we got to get into prayer. We got to get into prayer. In our class on Monday night, we shared that a pastor is a worker. Are we willing to do the work that is necessary to bring revival? One reason that so much scripture is misinterpreted is because we have heard the misinterpretation so much, and the misinterpretation had been programmed and retained in our mind and spirit. Another reason that so much scripture is misinterpreted is because we, you know, this is, if a famous person, listen, interpreted in a certain way, that must be correct. I have heard some famous people misinterpret certain passages of scripture. As a matter of fact, one pastor was teaching on the most misinterpreted scriptures in the Word of God, and he said himself, I misinterpreted this last Sunday. I have a lot of studying to do myself, but I've committed myself to being a student of the Word because I don't want to lead people in the wrong direction. Over the last few years on Command Your Morning, I believe I've grown up a little bit in the Word of God. Nobody else might not believe. I believe I've grown up a little bit because I study and I've learned to study to show myself approved unto God, a workman that need not be ashamed, according to 2 Timothy chapter 2:15. And so the leader must be a student of the Word, and not just the leader, those in the congregation. If you want to see revival in your life, you got to learn to be a student of the Word. 2 Timothy 2:15 says, rightly dividing the word of truth. This is what one of my students released to me after class on Monday night. We talked about how John 10:10, how the thief in John chapter 10, verse 10 is often misinterpreted. I've misinterpreted it even after I understood the actual interpretation. Why did I do that? Because the misinterpretation had been programmed in my mind by hearing others misinterpret it. This is what happens. But this is what one of my students said about what he is learning. My student is not a pastor. He is just a member of the congregation, a student at Victoria's Living Bible Institute, who is learning to unlearn some things that he has learned. He says, I've slowly learned how to unlearn previous assumptions and carefully study on my own since I've been at VLBI. I find new revelation every time I read, because now I read in the spirit and not in self and in my flesh. It's amazing how God covers us, even in our unawareness of scripture in life, sometimes fully covering our misinterpretations until he brings us into a more perfect knowledge of him. I also now find myself learning how to hold things close to my heart, like Mary, as some may not be ready to come into the full knowledge of Christ and God's word. I'm so careful with what I used to run recklessly with. And this is because revival has come to his life through the study of the Word of God, through obedience, because this particular individual said, the Lord told me this was my school. Through his obedience and through his diligence and through his study of the Word of God, revival has come to his life. And so, ladies and gentlemen, when we listen, learn, get into a place where prayer is priority, study of the Word is priority, what God desires is priority, revival can come to our lives. A congregation's love of being rigid in worship hinders revival, because David's wife, Michal, criticized his worship and put her mouth on God's anointed. The Bible says she was struck barren. And so, ladies and gentlemen, a barren church loves rituals and religiosity. But I want to encourage you this morning that now is the time to worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. When you do that, that's revival. And so, ladies and gentlemen, that's all we had time for. Went a little longer than I wanted to and kind of had to move a little ahead of myself, but to God be the glory for the things that he has done. I want to go back real quick before we go into prayer. I'm going to ask Deaconess White to take us in for prayer this morning. But as my student said, I also now find myself learning how to hold things close to my heart, like Mary, as some may not be ready to come into the full knowledge of Christ. In other words, those who are not really ready to come into the full knowledge of Christ are not ready for the revival. He says, I'm so careful with what I used to run recklessly with, because revival has come. And so, Lord, send revival part two. We'll continue with this Monday morning if it's the Lord's will, but I am going to ask Deaconess Miranda White to take us in with a word of prayer.
Lord, send revival. God, we just thank you this morning, God. God, that you have revived us, God. God, to seek you, to seek your face, to seek your words, Father. Father, we thank you for giving us a new heart, God. God, we thank you for putting in us a new spirit, God, from you, Father. Father, that you're not allowing us to lay dormant, God, that you're not allowing us to sit on things that you have placed for us to do. So, Father, we thank you for this revival, God. You're reviving our hearts. You're reviving our minds. You're reviving our spirit. You're reviving our families, God, and our children, God. You're reviving this nation, God. God, help us to follow your words, God. Help us to understand what it is you have for us to do, God. God, don't allow us to lean on our own understanding, God. God, as we acknowledge you, revival will hit this place, God. As we acknowledge you, revival will hit our families, God. As we acknowledge you, revival will hit every church in this nation, God. As we, oh, Jesus, oh, Lord, as we acknowledge you, God, revival will hit this world. So, Father, we thank you and we honor you, God. God, as we go forth in your word, God, that we are not afraid to stand firm, God, that we are not afraid to walk and talk right, God, that we are not afraid to be obedient, God, God, that we are not afraid to lift your name, Father. So, Father, we thank you and we honor you, God. God, for you are God of God. God, you are the King of kings, God. You are the Lord of lords, God. There is no other like you, Father. Father, you're reviving this nation from any disease. You're reviving this nation from all hurt, harm, and danger, God. You're reviving this nation from any evil spirit, Father. Father, you're causing us to lift up, God. You're causing us to raise up, God. God, and we appreciate your love, God. We honor your love, Father, for it is pure, God. Our heart will stay on you. Our minds will stay on you. Our soul will stay with you. So, Father, we thank you on today, God. God, that you're not leaving us alone, God. You're allowing us to go with you, to walk with you, to talk with you, God. God, that we begin to understand what it is that you have for us to do, God. God, that you're not allowing us to lean on anything else but you. So, So, Father, we lift your name, God. We honor you on this day and each and every day, God. God, as the children go to the schools, God, as the children go into the world, Father, Father, their souls are revived, God. Their minds are revived. That they will begin to walk and talk like you. They will understand what it is that you have for them to do, God. Let our hearts remain focused in your word, God. Let our souls remain focused in your hands, Father. Father, that we lift your name, God, that we honor you and that we praise you in everything that we must do, God. God, no matter what it is, God, God, we're understanding right now, God, that we want revival, God. We need revival, God. God, we want to be revived. We want to be able to walk and understand. We want to be able to go forward. We want to have power and glorify your name, God. We want to honor you, God. God, I know we no longer want to walk in our evil ways. We no longer want to listen to things that's not right. We no longer want to act like we know what's going on, God, when you've already given us direction, God. All we have to do is be obedient to be revived. All we have to do is just listen and understand your word, God. God, thank you for allowing us to study your word. God, thank you for the woman of God that you placed to be able to shed light on what you want us to do, Father. God, help us to stay focused on you, Father. Father, for you and you alone, God. God, we understand you and you alone have created everything, everything, God, and everything that has breath will have to praise and honor you. So, Father, on this day forward, Father, we promise to give you all the glory, honor, and praise, God. God, if we want to see anything move, God, we know we have to seek after you. God, if we want to see COVID-19 shed away, we know we have to seek after your face, God. God, I believe that this nation is healed. I believe that every sickness is healed. I believe that the people will be healed as soon as we turn from our wicked ways and lean on you, God. I believe that our families will be healed, God. As we pray and you revive us, God, I believe that the churches will be healed, God. God, turn us away. Help us to turn away, Father. Turn away from anything that's not like you, Father. Father, we thank you for your revival. We thank you for your revival. We thank you for your revival right now in the name of Jesus, God. As we go each and every day, God, as we continue to fast and pray, God, God, that we're understanding whatever I pray for, God, I'm trusting and believing because I believe in your word, because I believe in what you have directed us to do, God. Because I know that you are ordering our steps, God. Every step that is ordered is from you, God. And as you direct our steps, God, things will begin to change. Lives will begin to shift, God. Your nation will begin to rise up, God, and worship you. So, Father, we bless you on today, God, that no man, no woman, nothing, nothing can stand in the way, God. God, we pray for this president. God, we pray for the Congress. We begin to pray for anybody in the government, God. We pray for our schools, Father. We pray for our leaders that you place before us, Father. Father, we pray for our families, God. God, we pray for everyone, their mind, soul, body, and spirit to return to you, Father. Father, we pray that we go forward, God, and not go backwards, God. God, that we don't just continue to look back, God, that we're looking forward, God. But as we move forward, God, we revive, God. As our prayers go forth, God, things will begin to revive. God, as we just walk and talk like you, God, things will begin to shift in this nation. So, Father, we honor you, God, that nothing, nothing shall stand in the way of the word of God. And, God, on this day, and this day forward, we just want to give you glory and honor and praise that no matter what may go on, God, we seek your face. No matter what may go on, we understand your word. God, no matter what may go on, we're walking in your sight. God, no matter what may go on, God, your name will be glorified, God. Our actions will line up with your word, God. Our actions will go forth in your word, Father. God, we will study to show thyself approved to you, God. God, that we will walk right and talk right with you, Father. Father, we won't look at everything else that's going on in the natural, God. We will elevate up into the spirit, God, and we begin to pray, God. We begin to pray and honor and seek your face. So glory be to you, Father. We honor and praise you in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Amen. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. Thank you so much, Deaconess Miranda White. We give God praise today for this opportunity to return, to repent, to remember, repent, and do the first works. Going back to Revelation chapter 2, remember, repent, do the first works. Ladies and gentlemen, God bless you. God keep you. But if there's anyone listening that does not know Jesus as Lord of their life, repeat these words with me as much as you can. Father, it is written in your word that if I confess with my mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in my heart that God has raised him from the dead, that you've raised him from the dead, I shall be saved. Therefore, Father, I confess that Jesus is my Lord. I make him Lord of my life right now today. I renounce my past life with Satan and close the door to all of his devices. I thank you for forgiving me of all my sins. Jesus is my Lord, and I am a new creation. Old things have passed away. Now all things are new. In Jesus' name, amen. Welcome to the body of Christ. Remember, we said repentance from sin always preceded revival. And so, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the body of Christ. I want to encourage you to say, Lord, plant me where you want me to grow, and allow that ministry to nurture you. The Bible says in 1 John chapter 5, verses 4 and 5, for every child of God defeats this evil world, and we achieve this victory through our faith. And who can win this battle against the world? Only those who believe that Jesus is the Son of God. If you believe that, you can decree and declare, I win, I am victorious. That's all we have time for today. Somebody say, Lord, send revival. And as you pray for the Lord to send revival, you got to do it with joy. You got to do it with joy because, oh God, we give God praise for revival. We give God praise for peace. We give God praise for redemption. We thank God for salvation today. We just give God praise. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. I want to encourage you that if the Lord is speaking to you and he's telling you to partner with Command Your Morning, you can call Dr. Anita Harris at 912-288-4480, or you can visit our website and at theupperroomweightcross.com through Givelify or PayPal. You can set up your monthly contribution. If the Lord is leading you to do that, I'm asking those who would to partner with this ministry as we do our part to advance the cause of Christ through radio. Not everybody has access to Facebook, but these broadcasts are often posted on Facebook. Not everybody has access to social media. So we thank God for God continuing to use 97.5 FM to help in extending or advancing the cause of Jesus Christ. There is only one gospel, and that is the gospel of Jesus Christ. Ladies and gentlemen, if we have it ready, Kirk Franklin is going to take us home once again this morning. I guess this is Kirk Franklin week. Forever beautiful grace. God bless you. Those on the call, please remain on the line. TheUpperRoomWaycross.com.
How could you love me?
You don't keep a record of my wrongs, but Jesus, I do. That
I thought love was just a lie.
But then,
till it hung on Calvary,
every nail
was just for me. I will sin forever, falling in love with you.
My appreciation is that long, Jesus.
I will sin forever, falling in love.
Catch me.
Take my hand and lead me through.
This world is crazy.
I'm lost and confused. Come,
please,
my
King of Kings.
I'm so worthy.
And the truth is,
I don't deserve your
grace and mercy.
Grace and mercy.
Because
I'm so unworthy.
Hallelujah. Over and over and over again, how you erased every sin, Jesus.
I'm so unworthy.
You became flesh like me.
You left your throne because you're not worthy. I'm so unworthy.
I was sinking, sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore. But then at the last minute,
in my sin,
yes,
I was lost.
Till the lighthouse.
Till the lighthouse of the cross.
All the way from Calvary, you
saved to rest my knees.
And now by your blood.
And now I am redeemed.
That's why.
I will sin forever.
Forever.
Falling in love with you.
And friends, for the last hour, you have been listening to Command Your Morning Prayer Line. Live this morning from Nepal Ministries Incorporated, 702 R.C. Davis Parkway, out of Waycross, Georgia, where the pastor is Pastor Samuel Sellis III, the host of Command Your Morning Monday through Friday, 5 a.m. until 6 a.m., is Evangelist Dr. Renee Sellers. Don't forget, the morning program is recorded and aired again at 7 p.m. until 8 p.m. Monday through Friday on the Glory Bound train. Listen online at www.foxy97.com 24/7. Command Your Morning is a service of the Upper Room Ministries Incorporated, 702 R.C. Davis Parkway, Waycross, Georgia.
And I will.
I'll be fine.